Tractate Bava Batra, page 134. Here we are, Long Island, New York, going to study a fascinating subject, not only the story of Yonatan ben Uziel. Yonatan ben Uziel was not just a great sage, a great translator, and a great rabbi, but there is a lot of legends. One of the famous is the burial site. It's called Amuka, close to the city of Tzfat in North Israel. And there are people who go there and pray for matchmaking or for other needs. And it's a legend, which obviously in any religion you have this strong belief that that those who pray there will answer. Some hold in a year, some hold immediately, but the idea is it used to be an arduous effort to get there. I remember going there 30 years ago with my late father, and people reported of visiting his grave from all over the world that it makes a difference. So we're going to touch just a little bit, a vignette of his life and his greatness and how he makes a real difference for all of us. But the core subject, as we study in the past several days, is the law of inheritance. If the person left a certain will to certain people, and we need to handle problems such as disinheriting some members of the family, such as relocating the assets to different sources, such as showing partiality and more. So let's start on page 133b, five lines from the bottom of the page. Tanu Rabbanan, the rabbis tells us a story. Ma'aseh be'adam echad shlo hayu banav noagim kashura. It was a fellow that unfortunately he have children that do not follow the path of Torah, of mitzvot, of act properly. And the fellow felt that he really do not wish to have the children in a way misuse his estate that he worked so hard during his lifetime. Amad v'chatav nechasav liyonatan ben Uziel. He wrote his estate to a giant sage by the name of Yonatan ben Uziel. As we said, Yonatan ben Uziel is known first as a great translator of the Book of Prophets, part of the Torah believed to attribute to him, a student of Hillel the elders, which soon we're going to learn how great, important it was. So in a way, that individual relocate his asset to this great sage. So imagine you have a great man, Yonatan ben Uziel, who's sitting in the Beit HaMidrash, and an executor, or in our days an attorney, come to him and said, you have houses and money and all kind of things. So as a righteous man, me'asa Yonatan ben Uziel, what did he do with this estate? Machar shlish, he took the entire estate to that individual and he sold it. And the rabbis explained to us that it wasn't just in order to give charity or something, but he wants to show ownership and he wants others to follow, especially the family members. So he basically sold to others one third of the estate. Vehigdish shlish. And then he took one third and consecrated it. Vehechzir levanav shlish. And he took one third and gave to the children whom we just said did not behave properly, one third. Why is that? Simply speaking, some rabbis try to say. We just learned in the Mishnah. Yesterday we learned that the spirit of the rabbis are not conceived with the individual, that as much as you don't like certain pattern, certain behavior of your children, but still it can turn that they change the way, it can be their children be people of God and follow the path of Torah and mitzvot. So therefore, it's not in the spirit of the rabbis to disinherit the child and create animosity within the family. So whatever it is, Yonatan ben Uziel, the great man, put one third of the estate and in a way return it to the heirs, the sons of the late individual that gave him his estate. So as much as it appears as a great deed, as the Rashbam tells us the details, how exactly he did it, one of the points he said that the sons should know the reason he sold one third, it's a statement, making a statement to his children that this is basically mine, Yonatan ben Uziel said, and in a way I'm going out of my way to give you something. But then the great Shammai, Ba El Alav, Shammai Bemaklo Uve Tarmilo. So Shammai was obviously a giant sage. He came to Yonatan ben Uziel with his staff and traveling bag. So it's just an expression. He wants to protest that he took part, here's one third of the estate, and he gave it to that late person's children. And Rashbam said it beautifully, and he said, כלומר להתווכח עמו, he argued with him, Shammai argued with Yonatan ben Uziel, על שעבר דברי המת, that he violated the wishes of the deceased, שנתכוון לתת לו על מנת שלא יהנו בניו מן חסיו, that the sole purpose of that individual is to give it to Yonatan ben Uziel in order to make sure that the children will not follow the proper path of life, will not have part of that. And now all of a sudden, he, meaning Yonatan ben Uziel, did not follow the wishes of the person. Tosfot HaRosh, the way that Shita Mekubetzet explained to us, argue here with the concept. Giving a gift is giving a gift. The moment you put a tnai, you stipulate it, you're giving a condition, pre-existed condition, it's not in a framework of a gift. And therefore, the notion of many rabbis understanding that Yonatan ben Uziel felt a total freedom to do the way he thinks is the right way of distribution of that estate. Here is the way Yonatan ben Uziel responded to Shammai. Amar lei Shammai, im ata yachol lehotzi, if you are capable to go back to those people who purchased for me the estate, remember, it's the one third that Yonatan ben Uziel sold. If you'll be able, Shammai, to go back to the purchasers and get back the estate I sold them, את מה שמחרתי ומה שהקדשתי, and the other one third that I consecrated, אתה יכול להוציא מה שהחזרתי. So you can repossess what I return to that late person's children as well. So he basically hold that it's like a general concept of all three. All three are one third sold estate, one third consecration, one third the children. If you'll be able to take it, then you have the package. If you're not, you don't. 134, im lav, otherwise, as the property is mine, so I, meaning Yonatan ben Uziel, has the right to do the way I think it's right, אי אתה יכול להוציא מה שהחזרתי. Otherwise, you cannot have what. So in a way, Yonatan ben Uziel hold, I get it without any condition. When the executor or whatever it is came to me and says, so-and-so passed away, obviously I did not get any instructions. Otherwise, if he tell me that his condition is not to give it to his sons, he should spell it out lucidly, clearly. Since it never happened, so the way that Maharil Diskin explained in his responsa, he said that it has to spell out clearly. Otherwise, I in a way have the right. So if you'll be able to do that, then how do you say it? Be my guest. So in a way, Amar Shammai responded and he said, "Hitiach alai ben Uziel, hitiach ben Uziel." So obviously it's not the literal way. The Rashbam tells us, "Umilta de b'dichutahi," meaning he basically almost like a joking, and he said that Yonatan ben Uziel reprimanded me, which is he's right. Number one, even not a great child, he may do teshuva, he may have a good children. The late Rav Ovadia Yosef, may rest in peace, wrote in a responsa, "Shelot u'tshuvot yabia Omer," in Choshen Mishpat. He said, number one, we have to remember, for example, the story of Gazlanim, someone who is a robber, is a thief. So obviously, if he does teshuva, he can bring back whatever it was stolen. But if you, as a recipient, takes what is stolen from you, the spirit of the Rebbe is not so much with you. Why is that? It's called takanat ha-shavim. We want to encourage people to do teshuva. And for some people, the amount that was stolen was so great, and the hardship to compensate it is so high. So some people feel, I have no gate of repentance since I'm such a sinner. So therefore, in a way, it's a predicament, because you have to know what exactly the story is. The children really violated blatantly the severe law of Torah, and therefore the father followed the path of Torah and decided disinherited. Because if you go by the Dinei HaTorah, the law of the Torah, Rav Ovadia said, the sons inherited. Even, he held, that they not always follow the path as the way they wish, the parents wished. It's the way of life. Me'ikara mai savar. Now we try to have a logical reasoning to understand the mindset. What exactly Shammai hold at the first place? Mishum ma'aseh devet choron. Here we try to juxtapose to another story and learn the mechanism between two stories that have a derivative to us. So this is something we study in the past in Tractate Nedarim, page 48 in the Mishnah. Ditnan ma'aseh beveit choron be'echad shehaya aviv mudar hana'a mimeno. Listen carefully, because I'm sure some of us feel familiar with that. You have a fellow, let's call him Reuven. Reuven have a child, let's call him Baruch. And Baruch is a good child, he's a righteous child. He marry Esther, they have children, they have business. His father do not behave properly. For example, he walk in the Baruch's house, his son's house, and taking things without permission, not returning things properly. And this is adult son, adult daughter-in-law, and is already talk between the husband and wife. Esther and Baruch are really not really satisfied, happy to say the least, with too many incidences. His father takes the whatever it is and sell it and use it for gambling. So they reached a point that the son said, I have enough with this. And he put a kind of strong vow against his father. And what did he say? V'haya masi bno. So the son said look, you are prohibited to take any derivative of pleasure or any benefit for anything that I own. But then he wanted his father to partake with the grandson's simcha of the wedding. So it's a problem, because in one hand he prohibited his father from derive any benefit from him. On the other hand, he wants his father to attend his simcha, his celebration of his son's wedding. So what did he do? He called upon one of his friends. The good news, he have a good friend. The bad news, that friend was a big Talmid Chacham who was careful with this. So he said to him, ואמר לחברו, הרי חצר וסעודה נתונים לך במתנה. He said, they can, must probably make it as like opening banquet. So he said, this yard and the feast, the table that we serve, I'm in a way transmitted to you as a gift. In that sense, his father can go and use that place, that yard and that table and that food and that partake of the simcha, because in a way it's not his, it belongs to his friend. Ve'einan lefanecha, but here he put a condition that is trouble. In the language he said, it's not in your domain, either ela kedei or without, but the idea is she'avo abba v'yochal imanu bashuda. So in one hand, as we said, the son has a good heart. He wants his father to attend. But on the other hand, he remembered that he's still a vow, a strong vow that prohibited his father. So the Ritva in Nedarim 48 explained that by doing so, in a way, he's circumventing the system. Because in a way, he's giving away his yard, his feast, to his fellow friend. And therefore, the fellow friend can invite his father. But the problem with that is, it's a condition, it's a gift that incorporated with a pre-existing condition. Amar lo, the scholar, the friend of the son, Baruch, he said to him, Im shelihem, הרי הן מוקדשים לשמיים. If it's mine, I consecrated it to temple treasury. אמר לו, so he said, he protest ברוך, he says, no, you can't do that. לא נתתי לך את שלי שתקדישם לשמיים. I gave you a gift, but it was a clear precondition. What is the precondition? I want to make sure, as the Ritva tells us, that my father will be able to participate, and therefore that was the purpose for me giving it to you. I did not give you the right to go ahead and consecrate it to heaven. Amar lo, the recipient, meaning the scholar, the friend, said to him, לא נתת לי את שלך שלך, אלא שתהיה אתה ואביך אוכלים ושותים ומרצים זה לזה ויעבון תלוי בראשו. In a way he said, you gave me your property only, so you and your father will eat and drink and thereby appease each other. But the sin of transgressing the law of vow will be hung on my head. I don't want that. In a way, the Ritva explained that he wants to zoom in and understand the purpose for all of this. Is that a game or is that something that it's mine, it's real mine? אמרו חכמים, כל מתנה שאינה, שאם הקדישה מוקדשת, אינה מתנה. The sages said, if you take any present and that it's not so absolute, that if the recipient were to consecrate it, the gift will be consecrated. So it's basically, it's not considering a gift. The rabbis explained that the whole idea of limitation, if you're circumscribing the gift, and you said this present is with a certain precondition, it's not really part of that. It's called, I don't wish to be mesayya ledvar avera, to be part of something that is a violation of law. So let's understand, Shammai hold that this type of gift abrogated automatically the moment that that person violates the condition, the tnai. And in a way, Shammai was erroneous, was mistaken. Why? Because, as we said, you do not have chalot matana. The Kovet Shurim explained that you don't have any effectiveness of a gift if it's preconditioned gift. Now, I would like to elaborate this Sfat Emet, the great Ger Rebbe. The Rabbi Danderovich in Kovetz Yeshurun brings this Gemara, and basically, and others ask here, what's the meaning of all of that? The way that they try to say, I'll go further with that momentarily, but the key is, you know what, let me start with the Rambam, it will be much easier. Let's start with the Rambam. I'm reading from the Koran translation. Rambam Hilchot Nedarim, chapter 7. Any gift that the recipient cannot consecrate it, not a gift. For example, if one says to another, I hereby give you my meal, so that so-and-so, who is prohibited to drive benefit from me, due to a vow, will eat with you. That's exactly the case we just mentioned. The subject of the vow is prohibited to partake of the meal, as it is evident from the giver's statement that he does not have the intention to transfer the meal to the recipient unconditionally. That's basically the Oredea in 221. I heard many many stories that very much relate to that. Imagine you're giving to a non-Jew. In Israel, remember, we used to do it with the Arabs, selling the chametz. So imagine, what is chametz? For example, a bottle of beers. Like you have a basket full of bottles of beers. So you cannot give it to a non-Jew and said, okay, I'm giving you this basket, you buy it from me, but don't drink it during Pesach. It doesn't make any sense. Because anytime you put a status of limitations with the gift, it's an effective gift. I just remember not long ago, one of the famous Hamas terrorists was in Israeli jail. It was the era of the Ramadan. So in addition to the regular fast of Ramadan, he declared that his total fasts until they released, etc. So one of the Soharim, one of the people who work in the jail, purposely gave him tortit. Tortit is the Israeli chocolate wafer. Elite, it's one of the Israeli well-known company producers. So obviously he's in a fast and he's the head of the terrorists, he's not going to eat, etc. But the surveillance, the camera caught him ripping the cover of the chocolate wafer and eating it and tried to hiding it. And sure enough, the jail distributed it to all these fellow terrorists, and it's changed the whole perspective of looking up at these people. Anyway, since we talk about Yonatan ben Uziel and his greatness, now the Gemara elaborates on that and said, "Tanu Rabbanan, 80 talmidim ayu lo lilel zaken, 30 mehem ruim shetirei alem shechina kemoshe Rabbeinu," which means that you have a students of Hillel HaZaken, 80, 30, Rabbi Chaim Shmulevitz said, it's not Moses, it's like Moses, in a sense that they are similar, they deserve, the generation not deserve to have them in that level, but they have kind of capability. 30 mehem ruim shetamur lehem chama k'yoshua binun. We all know the story in the book of Joshua, chapter 10, that the sun stopped because of Joshua. So therefore, because they are so important, we compare them to Joshua. That's the way the Aruch Laner explained. Ve'esrim benoniim, gadol shebekulam, the greatest for all of them, amazingly, Yonatan ben Uziel. Katan shebekulam, Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai. When I was in Amuka, I saw it on the graveside of Yonatan ben Uziel, this statement. Anyway, Amru alav al Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, this is kind of, in our perspective, the lowest. And remember the statements in the ethics, how great he was. But they said that he was so knowledgeable, and this is the lowest, שלא הניח, didn't left מקרא ומשנה, which Rashi said in Sukkah 28, that he knows all of that, גמרא, הלכות, ואגדות, דקדוקי תורה ודקדוקי סופרים, כליל וחמורים, גזרות שוות, תקופות וגימטריות, meaning he knows everything. Everything and anything, including the secret part of the Torah. ומשלות כובסים ומשלות שואלים. It's all kind of different understanding, different avenue of understanding the Torah, including the esoteric part, the secret, the verbal analogies, the numerical value of the Hebrew letters, the parables of launderers, which is folk tales, the parable of foxes. It's all secrets of the Torah. ומשלות כובסים ומשלות שואלים, שיחת שדים, the conversation between demons, again, above us, just. ושיחות דקלים, שיחות דקלים, in general, it's the, like the word of botanics. You see two trees, it's like, יפצחו לפניכם רינה, we said in the book of Tehillim, that הערים והגבעות ימחאו כף. So in that sense, it's a special highest level of that the Almighty granted the understanding that he was able to understand שיחת הצומח, as Rabbi Nachman Breslov said, that it's a conversation between the trees, and תשובות הגאונים said that it is a capability when the tree is moving to a certain way to understand what's in between. ושיחת מלאכי השרת, a conversation between the heavenly angels. So again, those who have amulets, that's basically the source of the kmeot, that they have hashbaot, they have all kind of oath upon certain angels. In the 11th century, one of the great rabbis was Rabbi Abu Lafia. He wrote several books. One of them is the book Hatzerufim, that he put different words that make a certain oath, certain angels to do certain things. Obviously, it's way above the scope of our understanding. ודבר קטול וגדול ודבר קטן, דבר גדול מעשה מרכבה. So the great thing is they understand the divine chariot from the book of Ezekiel, which again it's something that it's very high level, or the way the Ritva said that it's the highest level of understanding certain godly entities. ודבר קטן אביודע ויד רבה, in a small matter, again the discussion between Abaye and Rava, that's much later generation. And because it was forgotten over generation, so he was capable to remember, לקיים מה שנאמר, להנחיל לאויבי יש ואוצרותיהם המלא. So the Gemara asked, וכי מאחר דקטן שבכולם כן, if this is the least of them, is so prolific, which is רבי יוחנן בן זכאי, גדול שבכולם על אחת כמה וכמה, the greatest of all, which is Yonatan ben Uziel, understand in such a highest level, אמרו עליו Yonatan ben Uziel בשעה שיושב עוסק בתורה, כל אוף שפורח עליו נשרף. He said that when he studied and occupied himself with the Torah, the sanctity that he generated was so intense that any bird that will fly over him will be burned, will be, in a way, will not be able to survive. So Hasidic sect, they say that if that's the student, how much is the Rebbe? But it's not the way the Yerushalmi. The Yerushalmi said in Tractate Sukkah, they said that Yonatan ben Uziel burned in the 4 cubits, 400. Hillel HaZaken in a radius of 100 cubits. By the Kabbalah, just a vignette, there is a concept that it's called a angel, מלאך שנקרא אוף, is a name of angel that's called a bird. And they have a מלאך that it's a שרף, that it's above. So therefore it's a, like in the book of Eichalot, is a different level. So each מלאך, each one of them, it's a different מדרגה. And it becomes, because of the Yonatan ben Uziel Torah, he high rise in his level in Na'asa Saraf. That's base of Rashi in Sukkah 28, that said that when Yonatan ben Uziel studied Torah, Malachei Asharet, the heavenly entities, or in Gadol, together it's called in Greek methodology Pleroma, which means all those heavenly entities were around him, and the sanctity was so intense that, as they said in the Song of Songs, Chavirim makshivim lekolech hashmi'ini, which means that, as Raziel HaMalach explained, that there are certain correlation between Hevel HaPeh, that's something that one study and pray and connectedness or influence between the physical and the metaphysical world. And that's what King David said in Tehillim 104, Meshartav Esh Lohet. Obviously, it's kind of, as we said, a little above the scope of our discussions, but just to grasp the point, as we said earlier, those who need Shiduch, visit his graveside, you never regret it. Anyway, here the Mishnah speaks about trust of a person if he wants to say that certain new entity he declared that this is my brother or this is my son, how far that person deemed credible. Ha'omer ze bni ne'eman. If one says, this is my son, we hold that he is truthful. Later, the Gemara explained what's the ramification of that. Ze achi eino ne'eman. If he said, this is my brother, we do not hold him credible because they don't know him. V'itol imo v'chako. Remember, this is before the DNA, right? So the portion, so for example, Reuven and Shimon inherited from their father three different fields. So then Reuven came and he says that Levi is also one of the brothers. So since Reuven do not have a proof to that, Shimon did not have the obligation to accept that. That's the way the Or Sameach explained in L'chot Nizkei Mamon. But anyway, Met, if that one that it's was in a question, the person that was in question passed away, now the property yachzehu nechasim limkomam, let's go back to the brother, to which means the possession of the brother who testified on his behalf, from whose portion he received a share, will go back to him. Naflu lo nechasim mimakom acher, if a property came into the man in question, possession from somewhere else, yirshu echav imo, the brothers of the one who testified shall inherit with the one who testified. That's basically follow his claim. They too are the heir of the deceased. I heard from one of the great rabbi and scholar, Harav Shaked Buhadana. It's a Moroccan rabbi in Israel. He relates a story about his family. They came from Morocco and his father was 13 years old when they traveled from Morocco to Israel. His grandfather was 80, but anyway, it was a lonely person that was my profession was a painter, but he was basically almost like part of their family because he was a lonely individual. His name is Yaakov Cohen. So before he passed away, he asked Rav Buadana's father to give the Tudat Zehut, to give the identification Israeli cards to him, because he wanted to transfer money to the children, almost like his own children, and he gave 15,000 shekel in those years was money to each and every one of all the children. The rest of the estate, which was a lot, he never talked, and his father, as a close friend, they never bothered. You know, people don't like to speak about it. Unfortunately, when this fellow passed away, from nowhere, a total secular lady came in, all kind of weird documentations, but she claimed that she is his daughter, and she get his apartment. So again, that was old generation of righteous Moroccan people that don't want to go to Moroccan Jews, that don't want to go to court and fight, but He basically asked, where are you all those years? We took care of your father who was so lonely, and we thought that he never have his own children. But anyway, it can happen, unfortunately, that when a person die and left a lot of money, all of a sudden there are people who claim that they are relatives, they are connected, etc. It's said common in our society, but it happens. When a person die poor, it's hard to get a minion sometimes. If a person like that, everyone try to be his somehow associated relatives or something. Anyway, the Mishnah said, Zebni Neeman. If a person said, this is my son, we trust that he's truthful, he's deemed credible. Lemai hilcheta, what exactly the halachic derivative from that? So the answer is, they said, Amar Rav Yehuda Amar Shmuel leYorsho, that he can inherit from him. The son inherits from the person who speaks. ולפתור את אשתו מן היבום. That he basically exempt his wife, as we study in Tractate Yevamot and Ketubot, from Levirate marriage. Why? Because that person questioned his claim that he's his son. So his wife is not required to enter to any form of Levirate marriage since she have a child together with him. So both Levirate marriage, Yibum, and Chalitza, release, she's exempting from that. I would like to share with you the Shulchan Aruch, Choshen Mishpat, both 279 and 280. If one claims that a specific person is his son or his brother, Magid Mishnah said, that's in the Rambam, Ilchot Nachalot, chapter 4, even if they are not presumed to be related, the rabbinic court accept his claim with regard to inheritance, whether he make this claim when he is healthy or he is in his deathbed. If there are two brothers, let's call them name, Reuven and Shimon, whose father died and they are not known to have any other brothers, and Reuven claims that the third person, Levi, is their brothers as well, and Shimon claims not to have any knowledge of the matter, in such a case, Shimon receives half of the inheritance, since, as far as he is concerned, there are only two brothers, the Sma said. Reuven receives a third, as he admits that there are three brothers, and Levi receives the remaining six. If Levi subsequently dies, the six that he received is inherited by Reuven. If Levi have other property, Reuven and Shimon divided between them, as Reuven admits that Levi is Shimon's brother as well. Now you see in Shulchan Aruch the Rema in Choshen Mishpat 280, Rema citing the others, that the only actual property that Levi received from their father property, or property Levi received in exchange for the property, is inherited by Reuven. Any other property of Levi is divided equally. You see also this on the Magid Mishnah and the Rambam, Ilchot Nachalot, chapter 4. Page 134b. So the Gemara asks a question, Le'osho Pshita. If we understand that he can give his estate as a gift, for sure he is deemed credible to say that this is his son to get the Yerusha. Soon we see the Ktzot Achosh in Reish Tzadik, Reish Ayin Zayin. But anyway, the Gemara said, Liftor et ishto min ha'yibum mitzrich alei, to exempt his wife from Levirate marriage. So therefore, we have the person who deemed credible to claim that this is my son, so his wife is exempt from Yibum, and she can, the Rashbam said, marry anybody without Chalitza. So the Gemara challenged and said, Hanami Tanina Mishamar Bishat Mitato Yesh Libanim. If someone was in his deathbed and he said, I have children, Ne'eman, we hold him credible. Yesh li achim, but if he said I have brothers, ein no ne'eman. So what you see here, his wife needs to have a Levirate marriage, and he's not credible. So the Gemara said, "Hatam delo muchzak lan be'ach." Here, it's not presumed to us that he have a brother. So therefore, we assume that the wife is already exempt from Levirate marriage, and his claim that he has a son, it's basically substantiate this presumption. Haha, but here this Mishnah, afal gav de muchzak le be'ach, even if he presumed to have a brother, so he claimed that it's accepted. Amar Rav Yosef, Amar Rav Yehuda, Amar Shmuel, mipnei ma amru ze bni Ne'eman, hoil bebaal shamar girashi tishti Ne'eman. So the same way, in a way, is almost like a ta'anat migo. The same way that he said that I divorced my wife and he's credible, and his wife is exempt from Levirate marriage, he's also exempt from this claim. Now, the Ketzot HaChoshen in Kuf Mem Vav, Seif Katan Yud Aleph, he brings a machloket rishonim, a disputation among the early sages, if someone does that. He said that this so-and-so is my son and exempt his wife from the Yibum, if she allowed to marry Kohen or not. The Rashbam said that's not, because we don't have Migo de Gerashti. Tosfot Baramban said that she can marry a Kohen. The Kovetz Shiurim basically deal here with the whole idea of koach ne'emanut, how far you deem credible with this migo, because in one hand we trusted him, on the other hand, when it's come to this type of claim, it's kind of, it's not easy to take his word just in a face value. My great brother-in-law, Harav David Avraham Mandelbaum, in his book Daf al Daf, wrote a lot about this sugya. You're welcome to read more. As we said, we're running out of time. We can elaborate for a long time with this. Anyway, here Rav Yosef asks if this is a true statement. If, because the Gemara in Nedarim 41 said that Rav Yosef unfortunately was sick and he forget part of his study. Amar Rav Yosef, Marei de Avraham, Talei Tanya, Belo Bidelo Tanya. So here he said that, in a way, Master of Abraham, this reasoning makes that which is taught in the Mishnah dependent upon that which is not taught, which is neither in the Mishnah nor in the Braita. Zebni, it's in the Mishnah. Baal, that said, Girashti et ishti, I divorced my wife, is neither in the Mishnah nor in the Braita. Rashbam explained that basically it's hard to go that direction. Itmar achi, Itmar amar Rav Yehuda. Rashbam doesn't hold that Rav Yehuda said it, but anyway, Amar Shmuel, Mipnei ma amru ze bni Ne'eman, uil biyado legarsha, same ta'anat migov, and he exempt her from Yibum. Amar Rav Yosef, hashta be'amar tamrinan uil, Baal amar girashti dishti Ne'eman, uil biyado legarsha. Now it's a... disputable view. Ki ata Rav Yosef, Rav Yitzchak Bar Yosef, when Rav Yitzchak Bar Yosef came from Eretz Yisrael to Babel, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Baal Shamar Girashti Dishti Eino Ne'eman. It's not credible. Menapeach Rav Sheshet Biyedeh, Rav Sheshet waved his hand disparagingly, and he said, Azal Ho'il de Rav Yosef. So he basically said that the whole Ho'il, all the sins, the power of divorce of Rav Yosef is gone because of this Rabbi Yochanan statement. So the Gemara said, is that true, Ini? Is that true that Rabbi Yochanan hold that a husband is not deemed credible to say that he divorced his wife? Ve'amar Rabbi Chiya bar Avin, amar Rabbi Yochanan bal shamar girashti ishti ne'eman. The husband said that divorced my wife is deemed credible. Lokashia kan, in our sugya, the first memra, that the husband is not trustworthy to say that he divorced his wife, lemafrea. So if it's a retroactive testimony, vekan lehaba, the other one is in the future where he says that he divorced her on the same day or without specifying a day, in which case his statement is relevant only for the future. Now, Ibayalu, Amar le mafre amau le imun ele haba. If he used that language of retroactive, can you take it for the future, from that moment and onward or not? Mi palginan dibura o lo palginan dibura? Do we divide the husband's statement or not? Rav Mari ve Rav Zvid, chad amar palginan ve chad amar lo palginan. One said that we divided, the other one said we not. מה יש למידי רבא דמה רבא איש פלוני בעל אשתי? If someone said so and so engage in sexual intercourse with my wife, הוא ואחר מצטרפים לאורגו. So the question is לאורגו ולא לאורגה. So the Gemara said, בתרי גופי פלגינן. We talk here to two different bodies, which is husband wife. So we divided the testimony, which means we take the entire, לכל העדות, the Rashbam said. בחד גופה, if one person, one wife, retroactively, in the future, לא פלגינן. So, some said בתרי גופי עדות, בעל ונבעלה, is a Tosfot in Sanhedrin, page 9, and also the Kovet Shurim, deal with that, כאילו שרבי עקיבא איגר and others. I would like to conclude with just a vignette from the Sfat Emet. We mentioned earlier very interesting view of a in a way comparison between Yonatan ben Uziel and Rabbi Yochan ben Zakkai, and we said that Hillel HaZaken have 80 students and the highest was Yonatan ben Uziel and in a way lowest was Rabbi Yochan ben Zakkai. So Rabbi Danderovich in a book called Kovetz Yishurun bring the Sfat Emet, who said that if you go by the Shalshelet HaKabbalah, the way that we received, we do not have Yonatan ben Uziel as Ma'atik HaShmua, only Rabbi Yochan ben Zakkai. So he explained that because Yonatan ben Uziel was such a highest level, he will not be able to relate to others the same as Rabbi Yochan ben Zakkai, that was able not only to be a recipient, but also the one who delivered it. Obviously, there is a lot of challenges of this view of a Sfat Emet, and it's a lot of statement. The Kotzke Rebbe said that the Ofan Israf, it's a expression of Madrigot. As we said, it's a Ritva in Sukkah 28, and there's way more to discuss what exactly involved with that statement that every bird at the top of his head when Yonatan ben Uziel study was burned. Is that figuratively, is that literally, and as we said, is a broader of explanations.